fears God and walks in His ways. The man who fears God and walks in God's ways. Blessed is everyone. Every man who fears God and walks in God's ways is blessed. Enviably happy. Every man who fears God and walks in God's ways, he is enviably happy. Verse 4. Behold that this shall the man be blessed. Thus shall the man be blessed that feareth the Lord. Thus blessed. These are the ways in which that man can be blessed. Thus blessed. In this way, that man shall be blessed. Last week we were able to consider five things in what are the ways the man can be blessed. In verse 2, we are able to see, for thou shalt eat the labor of thine hands, happy shalt thou be, and it shall be well with thee. So how shall a man be blessed? Number one, financially he shall be blessed. Financially he shall be blessed. The Lord will bless the work of his hands. The Lord desires the prosperity of his servants. The blessings of the Lord will make one rich. So the Lord wants you to be rich. And number two, verse 3, the wife shall be as fruitful wine by the sides of thine house, thy children like olive plants round about thy table. Number two, your family will be blessed. Your wife, your children, your parents, your co-bonds. The whole family shall be blessed. And number three, that we read in verse 5, the Lord shall bless thee out of Zion, and thou shalt see the good of Jerusalem all the days of thy life. The Lord shall bless thee spiritually. The Lord will give you a good church. The Lord will give you the totality of His Word. The Word of God is mined from Zion, out of Zion. His law will proceed. The Lord shall bless thee with all spiritual blessings. So in Ephesians 1:3 we read, the Lord has made us to be seated in heavenlies and blesses us with all spiritual blessings. Number 4. Verse 6, as thou shalt see thy children's children. So the Lord shall bless thee with the longevity of life, with the longevity. With a long life shall the Lord bless thee. We can understand this in two ways. Literally, you'll be able to see your children and the children of your children. And spiritually, when the Lord saves you, you become an instrument in the hands of the Lord to save others. You'll be saving others. And your eyes shall see those who are brought into the Lord through your ministry. They would become soul winners. You are serving the Lord. And those who receive the Lord through your ministry, they'll become pastors, they'll become evangelists, they'll become youth leaders, they'll become choir masters. They'll become prophets. They'll become international preachers. My eyes have seen that. Those were in my VBS. Those were studied under me. They have become international preachers, not one, not too many. Your eyes shall see your children and the children of children. And number five, verse 6, yea, thou shalt see, true, thou shalt see the peace upon Israel. I call this solistic blessing. Your soul will be satisfied. You live in peace. Peace in your family. Peace in the church where you are. A few days back, I was talking to a servant of God who were really our motivating factors earlier. Those who were going before us in the ministry, in one way or the other, they are also responsible in shaping us. And presently they are attending a church where they are not at all satisfied. They are not sitting in the church in peace. When they do ministry, they are not doing it in peace. The Lord has called us to be in peace. Even in a family life, the Lord has called us to be in peace. A few days back, a sister came to me for counseling. Totally broken. She is going through a very, very difficult, sad path. I told her two options. Option number one, if you leave totally out of that situation, if you can be happy, leave out of that situation. No, I can't leave. You don't leave out of that situation, you want to continue in that situation, yes. Don't ask God to change the situation. Enjoy the situation. If you know the Lord is keeping you there for a purpose, enjoy that situation. Physical torture is that every servant of God, everybody who wants to do the will of God, in one way or the other, they go through some torture. Like a martyr, endure the torture, rejoice over that, don't weep over that. Don't weep over that. Whatever the situation may be, either you want to be in or out, be happy. Which is the will of God, try to do that. It will be painful. So many people are going through this type of physical torture, mental torture. Be happy in the situation the Lord has kept you. So peace is very, very important. Your eyes shall see the peace of Israel. Well, the peace of the land where you are in. I'm praying for our land. Lord, I must live in a land where there is peace. I must live in a country around me there should be peace. So these are the five blessings we meditated last week. Thus blessed, financially blessed, family way blessed, spiritually blessed, and with long life He blesses us, and also with totality, a solistic blessing, we'll be living in peace. We read verse 1. Blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord. So the second part, I'm continuing. What is the fear of the Lord? How do I know that I fear the Lord? How do I know that I fear the Lord? For this I'm going to tell you five things to cross-check yourself whether you really fear God or not. These five parameters are very, very essential to know whether we fear God or not. Whether we fear God or not. Number one, what is fear the Lord? Fear the Lord will have a reverence in our life. A reverence for God. I call this in Tamil பயபக்தி. பக்தி உள்ளவர்களை தேவன் தமக்காக தெரிந்து கொண்டார். A reverence. It may be தேசபக்தி, மொழி பக்தி, இறை பக்தி, a பக்தி. பக்திமார், பக்திமார், where there is a reverence for God. My dear brother, my dear sister, Saturday if there is a reverence for worshiping the Lord, you will develop reverence in such a way. Tomorrow we are going for the Lord's service. Tomorrow we are going to worship the Lord. Tomorrow we are going to worship the Lord. A thought will begin. A thought process will begin. I always take Saturday as a day of preparation. Mostly even ministerial assignments I don't take. Saturdays generally I don't go out for shopping. Saturdays mostly, not with legality. Saturday even I don't come here to the office. I spend more time with the Lord. This is not a practice after I started preaching. Because in the Bible I see a day of preparation. The day before the Sabbath, in the Bible it is called day of preparation, Ayatanar. So for the Sabbath, we need a day of preparation. So in the Sabbath they don't do any work. So probably they have to get their food ready. They can't go and buy that on a Sabbath day. So they have to buy and keep everything ready. So they got a day of preparation. Spiritually, it's a day of preparation. Then we come to the church. The Bible says, when you go to the church, take care of your walk. நீ ஆலயத்துக்கு போகும்போது நடையை குறித்து எச்சரிக்கை. I'm going to worship the Lord with a purpose in my mind. That's a definite purpose I got. I'm going to worship the Lord. So how should I dress? When I go for a marriage, or when I go for a party, I will have an idea how I should dress. I'm going to worship the Lord. How should I dress? How should I walk? How should I do my hair? I'm not going for wrestling. I'm not just going for a strolling. I'm not just going for a swimming. I'm not just going for a game of rugby. I'm going to worship the Lord. The mindset. When you enter into the court, you should be able to feel the presence of God. It's not that you imagine the presence of God. You are coming to the sanctuary. We are not making this a temple. There is no temple in the New Testament. I don't say it's a cathedral, but it's a house of prayer. This place is dedicated for God's work. We don't call this a church, we don't call this a cathedral. It's not an alayam. Nevertheless, it's house of prayer. So when you enter in this gate, you cannot engage in a chit-chat. It's impossible. Especially on a Sabbath day, when you have got the mindset to worship the Lord, you are able to sit and stand and talk there. You don't have reverence for this place. A few days back, when we had the VOT program, I was physically very weak, too weak to withstand. So the closing prayers, I just went out. By the time two servants of God joined me, they just started asking me about my health. They were concerned of me. They just came out immediately. By the time the closing prayer started here, I told both of them, wait, shh, prayer. When prayer was here, I could not stand there and talk. In the name of Jesus, in the presence of Jesus, I tell you. So those two pastors, those who came concerned of me, they also standing reverentially in prayer. We went to Trichy, some of our boys were with me for a retreat on August 15. When we were entering the campus of that church, they were playing national anthem. Immediately I stood still. Somebody ushered me, said, Ullavanga. I said, wait. I'm in this campus. There the national anthem is played. I must have reverence for my country. I may not understand Bengali. It's in Bengali. Probably because maybe a little bit of my knowledge. I've studied what is Jana Gana Mana, etc. But this is my national anthem. If you can stand there and talk, you don't have reverence. When you come and sit here, if you fear the Lord, you will have reverence. My dear brother, my dear sister, we used to sit on the floor earlier. And our church service at that time, it will start around 9 o'clock, it will be over at 4 o'clock. At times we will keeping our legs on one side. We will be scared to take and change the legs to the other side. We are in the presence of God. Every move. I don't say it's all legalistic, but it's natural, spontaneous. Spontaneous. We are in the presence of God. We are listening to the word of God. It's not only about this place. When you are paying your offerings, you are giving something to the Lord. What should be your reverence? When you receive the Lord's Supper, you are receiving this bread, you are receiving this cup, remembering the body that was broken for you, the blood that was shed for you. What would be your reverence? The yardstick to know that you fear God is your reverence. In appointments, in keeping your commitments, your Sunday school ministry, and going to teach the word of God. I'm teaching children the word of God. That's going to decide their eternity. Either to hell or to heaven. I'll be responsible. The reverence. That is the real fear of God. He that fears God shall thus be blessed. His family will be blessed, his finance will be blessed. Spiritually he will be blessed, he will be in peace. And he will see children and their children and the children of children. Do you have got that reverence? I cannot imagine somebody who has got the real fear of God. How would they be able to stand and talk and laugh when the minister, when the service is going on here? It is absolutely, they are hypocrites. They deceive others and they deceive themselves. They don't have the fear of God. It is impossible இட் இஸ் இம்பாசிபிள். So fear of God, the first step is reverence. Mr. Arun Shavri, an intellectual giant who was formerly editor of the Indian Express, then became a cabinet minister in Sri Vajpayee government, a very leading RSS personality. I love his intelligence. I love his interpretations. There are many things I don't agree with him. I read his books. In one of his books he writes, the substance is like this. Why he doesn't like Christianity? He says, when the service is going on, when the priest or the pastor is conducting the service of the, what he said, the mass, the service, some boys are standing out and they are talking. They are not showing reverence to the service. And they die. When they die, the priest says, the pastor says, oh, he goes to heaven just because he is baptized. He goes to heaven just because he is baptized. And another boy, he is able to see God in a stone. Kallilai kadavalai kandu. He is able to see God in a stone, falls prostrate before that stone, and he worships that stone, worships God in that stone. கல்லுல கடவுளை கண்டு அந்த கல்லுக்கு முன்பாக சாஷ்டாங்கமாக விழுந்து கல்லில் அவன் கடவுளை காண்கிற கடவுளை நோக்கி அவன் பணிந்து கொள்ளுகிறான். And if he dies, the priest says he doesn't go to heaven just because he is not baptized. If the baptism can make one worthy to go to hell, even if he doesn't have reverence for God, and the baptism doesn't make one go to heaven, though he shows reverence to God, I don't want that religion. Neither do I. I also don't want that religion. Somebody who doesn't have reverence for God because they are baptized, because their name is in the number on roll, the membership list, because they are paying their tithings, because they are attending the church, they don't have reverence for God. If you don't have reverence for God, God will not respect you. God will not honor you. If you honor God, God will honor you. Honor God with all your substance. That's not only with your finance. With all what you are. Honor God. Not only on Sunday. In every situation, when there's a prayer, when there's a Bible reading, honor God. My dear brother, my dear sister, so it's very, very important to show reverence. That is the fear of God. And when you don't have reverence, you don't have fear of God. And the second thing, in a very philosophic way, in a factual way, what do you mean by fearing somebody? What do you mean by fearing somebody? What I'm saying is fact, truth, it's philosophic, research oriented. When you really fear somebody, you will dread to offend that person. You will dread to offend that person. Just imagine you are working in a place. Good job, good salary. And in that place, probably you cannot get a job like that. In that place, they got a rule. You come 1 minute late for 3 days, you will be sacked. Even if you are late by 1 minute, for 3 days, you will be sacked. But you are not willing to give up that job. You fear to lose that job. I ask a simple, straight question. Will you go late? You will dread to offend that rule. Because it's a very good salary. For your education, for your background, you cannot get a job like that. You love that job. So if you go late, you lose your job. So you don't want to offend. You don't want to offend that law. You dread to offend because you fear. So the second symptom of fear is, you fear anybody, you'll dread to offend that person. You leave job. You fear your wife. You fear your wife. You'll dread to offend her. You'll dread to offend her. You fear your husband. You'll dread to offend them. My dear brother, my dear sister, love for somebody cannot take away this fear. When this fear and love come together, reverential fear that is, you love your husband and you fear your husband, that's a reverential fear, you will not do something that could offend your husband. You will not do something that could offend your wife. You love her and you fear her. You love her and you fear her. Somebody, your own child, met with an accident. You are rushing the child to the hospital. You are taking in your car. You are taking the child in the car. You cannot delay by 1 minute. They go very fast. And any jerk or any jolt will cause the child its life. How will you drive? You can't go slow. But any careless jolt or a jerk or a sudden brake will cause the child its life. How will you drive? You fear the child will die. You fear the child, your delay will cause the child its death. You fear a jerk will cause the child its death. You love the child. You fear a consequence. You dread to offend that child. You get my point? That's the real fear. There's a reverential fear. You love your job, you don't want to lose it, you fear. You love your wife, you don't want to hurt her, you'll fear. You love your husband, you don't want to hurt him, you'll fear. You love your child, you don't want to offend the child, you will fear. When you don't mind to offend somebody, you don't mind to offend their feelings, you don't mind to go late. If he sacks me from this job, some other job. If it is not this wife, some other wife. If it is not this husband, some other husband. Why should I worry about it? And my husband cannot sack me. My wife cannot leave me. This boss cannot leave me. Why should I fear? I can go when I want. What will he do after all? What will he do after? What will my husband do? He'll shout and go, that's all. Where will my wife go? Nobody for her. Where will she go? You don't allow. That's why you offend others. You're willing to offend somebody because really you don't have fear coupled with love. It's a psychological fact. Whether you agree with me or not, you offend somebody, you offend your boss, you offend your pastor, you offend believer, you offend your wife, offend husband, everybody you offend because you don't have fear for them. And also you offend God. You don't mind offending God because you don't fear God. God is in your pocket. What will God do after all? God knows. Whenever there is fear, He will not offend. Dread to offend. What I am saying is a fact. Now you put yourself on the way, on the balance. See whether you really fear God or not. Do you dread to offend God? You fear God, otherwise you don't have the fear of God. My dear brother, my dear sister. So what is number three? What is the fear of the Lord? Dread to offend. And number three, they say, anxiety and desire to please God. This is telescopic. When you fear God, you'll have reverence for God. When you have reverence for God, you'll dread to offend God. When you dread to offend God, you will have a desire to please that person. You don't want to offend your boss. If you offend your boss, you lose your job. You don't want to offend your boss. So what will naturally you do? You try to please him. You try to please him. You got reverence for your husband and you dread to offend your husband. For somebody it is totally unknown language. Many people, they don't have a reverential fear for their husband. You don't know anything. Be quiet. Many children, they don't have a reverential fear for their parents. Mommy, be quiet. Daddy, be quiet. Even they go to shut up, mommy. Surely they are waiting hellfire. Because the Bible says, you may have a Christian name, you may have a Christian church, you may have a Christian practices, but you don't have reverence for your parents. And you are not dreadful to offend them. When you have reverence for your parents and when you dread to offend them, the natural link is you try to please that person. You try to please that person. You do anything and everything that could please him. I take the same three situations. You love your job. You dread to offend that situation. Then naturally you try to do something that could please that person. You have a reverence for your husband. You dread to offend him. The natural sequence or consequence, you'll have nature to please him. You'll have a nature to please God. Those who say that they fear God, they'll have a nature to please God. Jesus feared God. Jesus said, I do everything that could please him. And God gave a certificate about Jesus. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. in whom I am well pleased. If you really fear your father, if you really fear your mother, you will try to do something that could please them. That could please them. When you don't want to do something that could please them, you don't have a real love for them, you don't have real fear for them. And you don't want to do something that could please God because you don't have fear for God. So fear of the Lord will give a reverential attitude towards God. Then you will dread to offend Him. And because you dread to offend Him, you will try to please Him. And number four, unconditional submission to God's will and God's plan. Unconditional submission to God's will and God's plan. I fear God. Because I fear God, I have reverence for God. I dread to offend Him. I desire to please Him. And unconditionally I surrender. I don't say, Lord, if you do this, I will do this. When I fear somebody, how can I say it like that? If you do this, I will do this. You don't have fear. You don't have fear. If I fear God, I say, let thy will be done. Let thy will be done. It comes from respect, it comes from not to offend, it comes from a desire to please. Ungeshtanga. Vana varren ponna pore. Nillana nikiran ukarna ukarne. An unconditional surrender to anybody who got reverence. My age, my experience may permit me to quote you from my life, plus I don't want to force it on anybody. Even before I came for the ministry. I wanted to do my PG course. I wrote my application, I took it my pastor, evening course. He just saw like this. Another day, I want to do my MSc in the evening college. Ukaranga. I said, Bible. I opened the Bible. Hebrews chapter 12. Read this verse. What's that? Blah, 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 blah. அப்பாவமான யாவற்றையும் நெருங்கி நிற்கிற பாவத்தையும் பாரமான யாவற்றையும் தள்ளி. வெயிட், வாட் தட்? பாரமான யாவற்றையும் தள்ளி. டு யூ ரெக்வயர் அன் எம்எஸ்சி? யூ ஹேவ் அ குட் ஜாப். எவ்ரி ஈவினிங் யூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு ப்ரீச். ஐ நோ. வை டு யூ வாண்ட் டு டூ திஸ்? நான் ஹீ ஷேர் வித் மீ ஹிஸ் டெஸ்டிமனி. I came out, tore my application and threw it. Not only to God, to the pastor, God has given me a head and an unconditional surrender. Unconditional surrender. There was an interview for me at Kunur, a very big school. I told him, he prayed for me and sent me. I attended the interview. I was selected, and at the interview itself they gave me the appointment order. In the appointment order I came down. It was exactly double the salary or double the income what I was getting on the planes. They gave a ministry-oriented assignment to sister also. In today's time, if I can get 60,000 here, it's 120,000, 120,000 there. Just double. I went straight to pastor. Pastor, I got my appointment order. அப்படியா? பை த டைம் ஐ வென்ட் அண்ட் மெட் அ பாஸ்டர் தேர், ஐ செட் ஐ அம் கம்மிங் ஃப்ரம் பாஸ்டர் சுந்தரம் சர்ச், ஐ வாண்ட் டு ஜாயின் த மினிஸ்ட்ரி எட்ஸெட்ரா, ஐ வாண்ட் டு ஜாயின் யுவர் சர்ச் எட்ஸெட்ரா. தே ஆர் வெரி ஹாப்பி சம்படி ஃப்ரம் பாஸ்டர் சுந்தரம் சர்ச் கம்மிங். ஐ செட் ஐ அம் பாஸ்டர் சுந்தரம்ஸ் டிரான்ஸ்லேட்டர், ஹி வாஸ் எக்ஸ்ட்ரீம்லி ஹாப்பி, எவ்ரி திங் பிளா பிளா பிளா. ஐ ஃபினிஷ்ட் அண்ட் கேம். ஐ டோல்ட் பாஸ்டர், பாஸ்டர் ஆஸ்ட், நீங்கள் அங்கே போயிட்டீங்கன்னா இங்கே உள்ள ஊழியத்தை யார் பார்ப்பா? இங்கே உள்ள ஊழியம் மெயின்லி இஸ் டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன். இங்கே உள்ள ஊழியத்தை யார் பார்ப்பா? ஐ ஜஸ்ட் கெப்ட் குவாய்ட். யாஸ்ட் மீ என்ன வித்தியாசம்? ஐ செட் டபுள் த சேலரி. இட் வாஸ் இன் ஆன் தேட் டேஸ் டேர்ம். டுடே இஃப் ஐ கேன் சே இட் இஸ் 1,20,000 ருபீஸ். He looked up and down and he said, அதை நான் தார் எங்கே ஊழியம் செய்ய? நட பை ஐ ரிசீவ் ஃப்ரம் ஹிம், ஐ வாஸ் ஒர்க்கிங், பட் மை ஃபாஸ்டர் சேட் டோன்ட் கோ, ஐ டிட் கோ. இட்ஸ் அ ரெவரன்ஷியல் ஃபியர். ஐ கேன் கோ ஆன் அண்ட் ஆன் அண்ட் ஆன் லைக் தட். வென் யூ ஃபியர் காட், the natural tendency an unconditional surrender to the will and the plan of God. I never had a big struggle. Maybe it's a grace, the way the Lord led me. When the Lord led me for the ministry, I resigned immediately. When the Lord wanted me to start this ministry, I started immediately. But I had love and respect for my pastors, but I obeyed God unconditionally. Surrender. When you are finding it difficult to surrender to God's will, to God's plan in your life, and you want God to do what you like, you want God to do what you like, it's all because of a very, very, very simple reason. Literally, you don't have fear of God. You don't mind offending God. You don't mind offending God. You don't have a deep desire to please God. The other day, somebody told the pastor, "Oh, pastor, if this is this, I leave the church." Who are you to take that decision? Who brought you over here? You may say it's a very gentleman's decision. Who brought you over here? Is it not God? Doesn't God have a plan for you? You don't dread to offend God's plan. You may think that you have fear God, but you don't offend. You don't dread to offend God's plan. You don't desire to do what is the will of God. You don't have an unconditional surrender to the plan and the will of God. That's the reason we take our own decisions. We choose our own churches. We choose our own lifestyle. What is the perfect will of God? What is the plan of God? We don't have all these things and we say, "I fear God, I fear God." Permit me, it's absolute rubbish. It's absolute nonsense. When I say nonsense, it makes no sense. It makes no sense. If you think that sincerely you love God and you've got all these traits, you don't mind offending God, you want your own will in your life, you want God to execute what you desire, your fearing God is nonsense. It makes no sense. It makes no sense. Your religion is only a ritual. You don't have a real fear of God. I'm not trying to offend you. I love you very much. I fear God. I don't want to offend Him. So I preach to you what He has taught me. You go to any psychologist, wise man, etymologist put these points. Do these points constitute the real fear for anybody? I would say these all are not necessary to have that mental attitude of fear. I love to meet that person and have some clarification. You can't have a reverential fear on somebody without having reverence for that person, without having a dreadful attitude to offend him, without having a desire to please him, without making an unconditional surrender to his will and his plan. You cannot fear somebody. You cannot fear somebody. And in addition, what is fearing God? What is fearing God? This is also very, very important. A total obedience to God's word. Whatever the form of God's word, his statutes, his precepts, his ordinances, his commands, his will, whatever the form may be, is only a precept, is not only an ordinance, is only a commandment, is not only a statute. No. Whatever the form of the word of God may be, a total surrender to the word of God, an obedience to the word of God, a desire to obey God's word. Without obeying God's word, you cannot love God. Without obeying his commandments, you cannot love God. Again, it's absolutely nonsense to say, I love God but I don't obey his commandments. It's absolute nonsense. I'm sorry to use that word, but I could not help it. I feel only that can make that point clear. It's absolute nonsense. It makes no sense. I say, I love God but I don't obey his commandments. I love my husband, but I don't do what he wants or what's good for him. I love my wife, I don't care what she says. Is this not rubbish? Is this not nonsense? I love my wife but I don't care what she says. How can you love your wife when you don't care for what she says? When you cannot totally obey the word of God, you cannot love God. You cannot love God, whatever the word of God may be. I say, whatever the form of that word of God may be. You can't say it's not a commandment, it's only an ordinance. The politicians, in their craftiness, in their cunningness, in their shrewdness, they may say like this, it is only a direction from the court, it is not a condition from the court. It is only an ordinance, it is not a law. Is only an ordinance. It is not a law. It is only the recommendation of the commission. It is only the recommendation of the commission. My dear brother, my dear sister, when God gives a direction, when God gives an ordinance, when God gives a recommendation, somebody who fears God, for that person, all these things are equal. He will not be arguing like a politician. This is only a direction from the court. It is only a recommendation of the commission. It's only in the form of a draft. It has not become a law. It's only an ordinance. That may be okay for a shrewd politician or a cunning politician to interpret things as they like. That's what Arinjar Anna said. சட்டம் ஒரு இருட்டரை வக்கீலின் வாதமே விளக்கு. ஸோ தட் லாயர் குட் சே இட்ஸ் ஒன்லி அன் ஆர்டினன்ஸ், இட்ஸ் ஒன்லி அ கமிஷன், இட்ஸ் ஒன்லி அ ரெக்கமெண்டேஷன், இட்ஸ் ஒன்லி அ டிராஃப்ட். Can you say all these things to God? Can you say all these things to God if you really fear Him? If you really fear Him, just because it comes to my mind, say one verse, one word in the Bible. You don't adorn yourselves with jewelry. You take that word. Is it a recommendation or a direction or an ordinance or a commandment or a statute or a precept? I don't know. Some Bible commentators say it's very clearly the Bible says you must not adorn yourselves with gold and pearl. You must not. That's the original language. You must not adorn yourselves. Decorate yourselves. Just think for a minute. You are wearing jewels, your culture, yes, removing, not removing. But if you really fear God, if you really fear God, can you decorate yourself with jewelry? Is somebody, maybe for a marriage or a special occasion, not in the marriage but in the reception, they want to decorate themselves with jewelry because of friends, because of relatives, they want to please everybody. They don't want to please God. They don't want to please God. How can they be thus blessed? How can they be thus blessed? Now, wearing jewels, right or wrong, is another question. Now, I'm not coming into that debate. But for a special occasion, you want to wear one more chain. You are wearing that to decorate yourself for that occasion. Then what about this one? Oh, it's not a commandment. Oh, it's not an ordinance. No, it's not a statute. It's only God's recommendation. It's only Paul said. It's only Peter said. My dear brother, my dear sister, the surrender totality. I don't want to please my father and mother. I may obey them. Every child here, according to the Bible, according to the Bible, in the Old Testament, from where we get our lifestyle, in the Old Testament, it is given every woman should obey their husband, every girl should obey their parents. If they make a decision and their husband or parents are contrary to that vow, that person is free from that vow and the Lord will require that at the hand of the father or at the hand of the husband. And every male child, till he is under 18, biblically to be more precise, till he is under 21, he has to obey his father and mother in everything. And he takes a vow. And the father is against that vow. That boy is free from that vow. And the Lord will require it at the hand of the father. The Lord will require it at the hand of the father. A free girl, a free boy, is not bound by this. Why should you care for the society? Why do you care what your friends say about you? Why do you want to please the world? What is the necessity for you to please the world? When you please God, that decides your heaven or your hell. When you please God, that decides your heaven or your hell. But when you please somebody else, how is that going to help you? In what way that's going to help you? If you please God, you will have a reverential fear for Him, and you will dread to offend Him, and you will desire to please Him, and you will have an unconditional submission to His will and to His plan, and thereby you obey His words. You obey His words. You will not be arguing on His words. You will not be arguing on His words. You will not try to form or shape your life by seeing others. Earlier, one elderly gentleman, I call him always uncle. That uncle asked me, Pastor, just it comes to my mind, that's what I'm saying. Pastor, you're telling that we should not wear jewels. What I say is many years back. But I understand Benny Hinn wears jewels, and wherever he goes for shopping and buys diamond jewelry. He said, "Uncle, is Benny Hinn your rolling model? And does the word of God tell you that you could buy jewel?" No, not like that, Pastor. But doesn't Benny Hinn know about it? I said, "Uncle, just take a hypothesis. Suppose you die before Benny Hinn dies. And later Benny Hinn change this viewpoint. He has changed in many viewpoints, and he takes a decision, okay, jewelry is not necessary for me, and he throws away that. Before that, you die and you go to heaven. You ask God. God asks you, why are you wearing it? You say, because Benny Hinn was wearing it. God says, look down. Look down, see what Benny Hinn is doing. Now what will you be able to tell him? Nobody is your rolling model. Nobody is your rolling model. Because Benny Hinn is wearing, because somebody else is wearing. It is between them and God. It's between them and God. But whatever the Bible says, in the totality of the Bible, a total obedience to the word of God, whatever the form may be, don't try to argue on the word of God. But see the word of God in the spirit, not in the letter. The apostolic teachings, what the apostles taught the church, we read them in the epistles. We read them in the epistles. We read them in the gospels, in Jesus' teachings. What the apostolic teaching. So you will have five things. One is telescopic into the other. A reverence towards God. A dread to offend Him, a desire to please Him, an unconditional submission to His will and to His plan, and a total obedience with no argument, with no reservation to the revealed Word of God. If you fear God, these are the symptoms that you fear God. Thus, you shall be blessed. You will be blessed financially. Your family will be blessed. Spiritually you shall be blessed. A long life you shall be blessed. And spiritually you shall see children and their children in the ministry. And more than that, you will live in peace. You will live in peace. And it is not enough that you fear Lord. When you fear the Lord, you walk in His ways. What do you mean by His ways? What do you mean by His ways? If you fear God, you will walk in His ways. What do you mean by His ways? Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The first step for wisdom. The onset of wisdom. You are going to walk wisely, you are going to behave wisely, you are going to invest wisely, you are going to live wisely. The first step for wisdom is the fear of the Lord. If you fear God, this, okay. When you fear God and coupled with and conjunct conjunction and. And walk in His ways, not in your own ways. When you fear God, you can't walk in your own way. You will not be walking in your ways. So very briefly I tell you, what is walking in the way of God? Number one, you make a note of it. All these things, you go home and meditate. Number one, Psalm 16 verse 11. I just read these things to you. Thou wilt show me the path of life in thy presence, in fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So when you fear God, thou wilt walk in the path of life. What will lead me to life, life everlasting? Again, I go to the jewelry. My concept is not jewelry, but I take jewelry for you to understand it's better. I love you all equally. I love the truth. Just take this instance. Will God throw away if I wear jewels? Will not God allow me to, I don't know why I talk about jewelry, but please listen. Will God throw me out of heaven if I wear jewels? Can't I go to heaven if I wear jewels? It may be a question. Will God say no to this evangelist, that evangelist? Yeah, I don't come to argument. A mighty evangelist of our time, it seems. He said in one meeting, I'll take my wife to heaven with jewels. I take my wife to heaven in jewels. Somebody came and told me. I said jokingly, that evangelist made a very big mistake. He won't take his wife to the graveyard with jewels. Before the body is removed, if there is a ring, they'll remove the ring. If the ring is not coming out, they'll cut the finger. If there is a ear stud, they'll remove the ear stud. And they cannot remove it, they'll cut that part. So I said, it's not a question whether he'll take you to heaven with jewels or not. They won't even take you to the graveyard with jewels. If at all out of much love, he buries his wife with jewels. I said, don't fear. By the time all the relatives could return home, the man in the graveyard, he will dig open the grave and he will remove the jewels. So it's not a question whether going to heaven with jewels or not. Even when they take to cremation ground, they may have sandalwood, etc., etc., but nobody is going to burn any body with jewels. Before they cremate that body, they will remove all the jewelry. Anybody has seen any time any relative is burnt with jewelry? Is it Hindu or Christians? So it's not a question whether you go to heaven with jewels or go to hell with jewels. You won't go to heaven with jewels, you won't go to hell with jewels. It's a question whether you obey and remove or somebody removes after you die. Jewelry is only for this earth, not for heaven. Nobody is going to heaven with jewelry. So that evangelist may say that I'll take my wife to heaven with jewels. He can't. My dear brother, my dear sister, but will anybody say, because you are not wearing jewels, you go to hell? Wearing jewels may have a question, go to hell or go to heaven. But is there a question, because you don't wear jewels, that's why you go to hell? No. What's that could lead you to life eternal? How my lifestyle should be? Or will I go to hell by hit my wife? She spoke like this, I gave two things. Will I go to hell because of that? God told Moses to hit that mountain. My wife is like a mountain, so I hit her. Now you may have a question whether I go to hell or heaven. But is there a question, because you don't hit your wife, you'll go to hell? So you choose between life and death. Somewhere it is very certain. Your future is decided. Somewhere it is not decisive. You still oscillate, you are unable to come this way or that way. Be prudent. You may have right to enjoy all things, but all things may not be profitable. All things may not lead you to life. So what is the way of life? When you fear God, lead in the path of life. Ask God, Lord, show me the path of life. The path that can lead me to life eternal. What if I do what I do, I can go to heaven. Help me to do it. Nobody is my rolling board. I don't want you to wear jewels because so-and-so is wearing jewels. I don't want to remove jewels because their auntie is not wearing jewels. No, it's not that. You fear God, you will dread for the word of God. And you will choose, you'll ask God to show you the way of life. So, walking in His ways means walking in the way of life. I go a little fast. Number two, in Isaiah 38, verses 8 and 9. Isaiah verses, chapter 38, verses 8 and 9. I just give you the points and go. Way of holiness. You will be holy unto the Lord. Your spirit, soul and body. That's His way. You'll behave, your walk, your lifestyle. Way means your lifestyle. Will be holy unto the Lord. Your dress, holy unto the Lord. Your hairstyle, holy unto the Lord. Your thoughts, holy unto the Lord. Your words, holy unto the Lord. Your spirit, holy unto the Lord. Your soul, holy unto the Lord. And your body, holy unto the Lord. Face is the index of the mind. Your lifestyle is the index of your thought. Your way will be way unto life. Your way will be way of holiness. Number three. Jeremiah 6:16. Good old way. That God said through Jeremiah, stop, listen, find out the ways of the world and which are good, and follow in that way that you may have rest for your soul. The ways of the apostles, the lifestyle of the apostles, the ways of your forefathers, their culture, their values, in that what is good, in that what is good, not the pseudo-evangelists, not the money-mongering pastors, not those who are craving for your money, the TV costers, the way of the world. Our saints, our forefathers for this apostolic revival, the way they walked, their faith, their lifestyle, their heavenly mindedness, their heavenly mindedness, even in ordinary, even in the food habits, culture, the world is good. Anything wrong in it, you leave it. Anything good in it, you follow. One of our believers, he is from an Anglo-Indian community, usually tells me, my grandmother is like this. She would not allow her daughters, her aunties, just to stand at the door in the evenings, just looking this side and that side. Why paathukittu? In our Madras English, simply standing. My grandmother will not do that. Is it good or bad? Is there anything bad in it? சாயந்தரம் 6 மணிக்கு மேலே வாசல் நின்று வாய் பார்த்துக்கிட்டு இருக்குது. இப்போ வாய் பார்க்குறதுனால சுத்த போகிறது, மாலுக்கு போகிறது, இஸ் குட் ஆர் பேட்? ஹர் கிராண்ட் மதர் வில் நாட், ஹிஸ் கிராண்ட் மதர் வில் நாட் அலவ் இட். ரியலி ஐ ஆல்வேஸ் லவ் அண்ட் அப்ரிஷியேட் ரெஸ்பெக்ட் தட் வில், பிகாஸ் ஐ எம் ப்ராட் அப் லைக் தட். ஆஃப்டர் 6 o'clock, ஆஃப்டர் த வீட்டில் விளக்கு வச்ச பிறகு நான் வெளியே இருக்க முடியாது. மை ஃபாதர் ஹஸ் நெவர் ஹிட் மீ, மை மதர் ஹஸ் நெவர் ஹிட் மீ, ஐ டோன்ட் ரிமெம்பர் எவர் தே ஷவுட்டட் அட் மீ. But I cannot imagine a situation where I was standing out after they got light in my house. விளக்கு வைக்கிறதுக்குள்ள வந்திருப்பா, எங்கள் அம்மா எத்தனை மணிக்கு வந்து சொல்ல மாட்டாங்க. விளக்கு வைக்கிறதுக்குள்ள எங்கள் வீட்டில் விளக்கு வைக்கிறது எனக்கு எப்படி தெரியும்? நான் விளையாட போயிருப்பேன், எனக்கு விளையாட்டு முக்கியம் இல்லை. எங்கள் அம்மா சொன்னாங்க விளக்கு வைக்கிறதுக்குள்ள வந்துருன்னு சொன்னாங்க, விளக்கு வைக்கிறதுக்குள்ளே நான் போவேன். எங்க நான் அடித்ததில்லை, என்னை திட்டினதில்லை, நான் ஒபே பண்ணியிருக்கேன். ஒன் டே ஆஸ்க் மை ஃபாதர் ஜோக்குலர்லி, யூ நெவர் ஹிட் மீ, இஸ் யுவர் நேச்சர் பிகாஸ் இட்ஸ் மை நேச்சர். நீங்கள் என்னை அடித்ததே இல்லைப்பா, அது உங்கள் குணமாக என் குணமானு கேட்டேன். மை ஃபாதர் லாஃப்ட் அட் மீ, நீங்கள் என்னை அடித்ததே இல்லை, அது உங்கள் குணமாக என் குணமா? நவ் திஸ் ஓல்ட் சேயிங் இஸ் குட் ஆர் பேட்? ஐ டேரெக்ட் ஐ டோன்ட் நோ டேடி, ஐ மீ டோன்ட் நோ மீ. யூ வாண்ட் டு வாக் இன் ஹிஸ் வேஸ், see what is good and old path, walk in that. Till this day I want to walk in the path my father taught me, my pastor taught me, my teachers taught me. I love it, I love it. They have seen that path. Anything bad in it, I don't want to go in that, but I don't remember anything bad in it. So if you want to be really successful in your life, thus shall you be blessed. Financially, family way, children, spiritually, thus you shall be blessed. See what is good and world way. Walk in it. Choose the way that leads you to life. Choose the way that leads you to life. Choose the way that's holy. Don't care two pins what your friends say. They want to go for a movie. They want to go for the last day, or just before exam. They just go for coffee day. Mother, ask your mother. You will go with your girl. That girl will come with his, her boyfriend. And that boyfriend will come with his boyfriends. And one of them will become your boyfriend. I don't know if you understand me or not. Your friends in the school, your dear friend, she is asking you just to go to coffee day. Is coffee wrong? No. Going to coffee day, is it wrong? No. Going with a friend, is it wrong? No. No, no, no. You are going with your friend. And that friend, that friend's boyfriend is coming there. Not your boyfriend. That girl's boyfriend is coming there, and with him his friend is coming. You are saying, uncle, is drinking coffee wrong? Uncle, is going to coffee day wrong? Uncle, is going with my friend wrong? What, uncle? Your friend's boyfriend's friend becomes your friend. Even a worse situation takes place today, your friend's boyfriend becomes your boyfriend. Shame. Is it because it is right? It is not right. Because there is no evil in it, it's not good. What is the end thereof? What is the end thereof? Many years ago, the day that Hepsi was born, after I saw the child in the hospital, I was going to my work spot. I was to meet somebody in the சர்ச் பார்க், ஒன் சிஸ்டர் மதர் சுப்பீரியர். ஸோ ஐ வென்ட் ஏ ஸ்மால் ஈட் அட் அப்னா பஞ்சாப். மை ஹார்ட் வாஸ் ப்ரோக்கன். There were two girls from Church Park, three boys from Don Bosco. I could make out from their uniform. During the school hour, they all wore uniform. They were taking some juice or some snacks there in the Apna Punjab, eat out. It's wrong. With uniform, school hour, sitting somewhere, add to it. One boy was keeping his thigh on another girl's thigh. She was wearing only a pinafore above her knees. I'm sorry to speak this. And I saw that my heart broke. Lord, my child is going to grow in this world. When she is 16 years old, this fashion would have gone 16 years long. The same fear Gloria Gaither had, that Bill Gaither wife. She wrote that song with a child in the hand. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. I really earnestly, the way of the world is good. Don't ask a question, is anything wrong in it, uncle? Is anything wrong in it? There is absolutely nothing wrong in it, but the end is totally wrong. My dear brother, my dear sister, so it's world that is good. And number four, in Hosea chapter 14 verse 9. Hosea chapter 14 verse 9. The way in which the Lord is leading you may not be a pleasant way, but it's a right way. Whatever the situation you are living in, the Lord is keeping you in a right way. The Lord was leading them through wilderness. It's a right way. I remember once our Pastor Sundaramaya said, Avar ungalai nalla valiyile nadathala, sevayana valiyile nadathugira. Not in a pleasant way, but certainly God will lead you in the right way. He will lead you in the right way. My dear brother, my dear sister, I remember, it comes to my mind, I'm saying this. One man, he's always complaining of his wife. He was telling his friend, oh, my wife is not like your wife. My wife is not doing like your wife. Every time you are saying like this. One day, that friend told him, yes, yes, my wife is not like you, your wife, and you are also not like me. You are also not like me. You have got a wife that suits you. You have got a husband that suits you. Don't say, well, your husband is not like that, your wife is not like that. You are not like that person. So what is right for you, the Lord has given you. The Lord is leading you in the right way. It may not be the pleasant way. Wilderness may be there. Red Sea may be there. River Jordan will be there. You may not have wheat, you may not have barley, you may not have olives, you may not have olives, you may not have wine. That's the right way. You don't choose a pleasant way, but make sure it's the right way. There are ways which seem good unto man. The end thereof is death. மனுஷனுக்கு செம்மையாய் சரியாய் தோன்றுகிற வழிகள் நிறைய, இது சரி இது சரி, இப்படி செய்யலாம் அப்படி செய்யலாம், இப்படி பிஸ்னஸ் பண்ணலாம் அப்படி பிஸ்னஸ் பண்ணலாம். மனம் திறந்து பேசுறேங்க. There may be ways which seem good unto men, but the end thereof is death. So it's not the good way, it should be the right way. And I say one more thing before I conclude. And it's very, very important. If you've got a copy of the Bible, can you turn with me to Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Matthew 7 verses 13 and 14, I call that a straight way. இடுக்கமான பாதை. Broad is the way that leads you to destruction. Always there are constraints around you. Always there are constraints around you. Your life would be pleasant. A straight path always gives you liberty to function. I know why I say this. A frog in a pond will have its freedom in the pond, or a fish in a pond will have its freedom in the pond. The moment the fish is thrown out into the land, it will die. A bird will have its freedom in the air, it cannot have freedom in the water. Now, a very good pianist, he has got a keyboard, maybe 3.5 octaves or 4.5 octaves or 5.5 octaves. He has got a freedom to play within those 5.5 octaves. Outside that, if he presses his hand, no music will come. Only within that framework, he will have a freedom. More the talents, less the octaves. Less the octaves. With 6 strings, you may have freedom in guitar. Outside that fretboard, you cannot imagine the stem, you cannot imagine a freedom. More the talents, less the strings. There was a highly talented man. Just with a coconut shell and a string tied to it, he was playing beautiful fiddle on it with one string. He was playing beautiful fiddle on it, begging on the train. There was a cine director. He saw this man, his talent. He took him to the cine field. He became a great musician. My dear brother, my dear sister, the other day I got on WhatsApp. A man had in front of him one cup, one dappa, one plastic container, some 7 things in it. All waste things. One plastic container, one dappa, one bowl. With 2 sticks, he was playing Janaganamana in that. Talent. Whatever you don't have, praise God for what you have. Don't worry what you don't have. Don't worry what you have. Don't worry what you don't have. Happy with what you have. Straight is the path that leads you to success. Straight is the path that leads you to heaven. Broad is the way that leads you to destruction. Whatever the limitations you have got, be happy in the limitations. And you shall find great. I'm talking about in a worldly sense. Spiritually. We always say, Lord, you lifted me out of a straight path and made me stand on a broad place that's in heaven. The Lord will deliver you from all your straight situations and make our feet stand in a very broad place that's in heaven. Be happy with the difficult situations you face in your life. When you fear God and walk in His ways, what is walking in His ways? Choosing the way that leads you to life, choosing the path of holiness, choosing the old and good ways, choosing the right ways, and choosing the straight path. And when you walk in His ways, you shall be blessed. You shall be enviably happy. The Lord shall bless you out of Zion. You shall have financial blessing, family blessing, spiritual blessings. You shall have blessings of long life in your ministry, in your personal life. And above all, you shall live in peace. Shall we take a solemn decision? Just I preached this in the marriage of our believer Sundar. I just want to be very fast. I don't want to extend it to one more week, that way I conclude. But I love this psalm very much. The psalm will surely shape your life, and every believer in Kormi should be blessed of the Lord. The Lord shall bless you out of Zion. Just stand to your feet. Take a solemn decision in your heart. Take a solemn decision in your heart. Lord, give me a heart to fear you and to walk in your ways.